Black lights and booze burn when I record for Watts, and every black like Troy Davis who never had a fair shot.
My two guests this evening, as we talk about Oscars so black, Oscars black as fuck, as is the term, right, in response to Oscars so white a year ago. The two guests to my right, first is Professor Stephanie Dunn, who is an associate professor and director of the Cinema, Television, and Emerging Media Studies program at Morehouse College in Atlanta. She specializes in film, creative writing, and African-American and American culture and literary studies. She authored the 2008 book, Bad Bitches and Sassy Supermamas, Black Power Action Films, which is University of Illinois Press 2008, which explores the representation of race, gender, and sexuality as they play out in the black power and feminist influence explosion of black action films in the early 1970s, including Sweetback's Badass Song, Cleopatra Jones, and Foxy Brown. Natalie Bullock Brown, who is also my regular interlocutor every month on Back Channel, is an award-winning and Emmy-nominated producer and consultant and professor of film and broadcast media at St. Augustine's University in Raleigh, North Carolina, for more than a decade. Bullock Brown serves as a co-host of Black Issues Forum, a public affairs program on UNC TV, and was an associate producer on Ken Burns' 10-part PBS series Jazz. Bullock Brown's current project is Bartman, Beyonce, and Me, a 60-minute documentary film which she produced and directed that explores the impact of white supremacy, racism, sexism, and patriarchy on black female feelings about beauty and sexuality. How are you two doing?
We're doing great.
So, Natalie and Stephanie are two of my favorite interlocutors. Natalie and I get to do it publicly. More often than not, it's Stephanie and I talking on the telephone, or her contributing to New Black Man in Exile. And since I was having all these swirling conversations around film, I thought it'd be great to bring the two of them together in conversation. One of the things we also try to do with Left of Black is to be very cognizant that not every institution circulates like a Duke. And that we have vibrant educational institutions, you know, just really literally up the block, our treasured historically black colleges and universities. So I'm very glad also to kind of bring that together in this conversation. So, you know, last year, April Rain creates a hashtag, Oscars so white. And suddenly there's an explosion of commentary, particularly in the black Twitterverse, around the lack of color in the Academy Awards. When all of that first went down, and I know neither one of you are really that into Twitter, but as the protest, but as the protest started on Twitter and then kind of elevated to mainstream conversation, how did you feel about that protest? Did you think it was something that had to be said at that time? Is it something that should have been said 25 years ago? What was it about that particular moment last year that energized this conversation about race in the Academy Awards?
I'm not sure what sort of motivated the type of response that came a year ago. I feel like the conversation has been going on for a long time, and I think that there's something certainly about social media and definitely about black Twitter that really energizes conversations about issues that have, you know, been circulating for years. And so I think it was just one of those things, you know, April Rain made a comment about Oscars So White, they want to touch my hair or something to that effect. And, you know, didn't expect for it to go viral. But I think the fact that it did go viral just reflects the fact that, you know, people were paying attention to the complete lack of African-American and other people of color, African-Americans and other people of color being nominated and recognized and acknowledged for their work in the movie industry. And I just refuse to believe that suddenly this year, now that we have, you know, so many acknowledgments, so much recognition, so many nominations for Black actors and actresses in films, that all of a sudden, you know, we've just like gotten our stuff together and now we're worthy of being nominated. So I think, you know, that there is, I don't know what that perfect storm was, you know, that sort of galvanized this conversation in the way that it was galvanized, and to some extent has sort of predicted and anticipated what we're seeing now. Although, of course, you know, many of the films that were nominated, you know, now this year had begun production long before Oscar's So White. So it's an interesting question.
And I would echo what my sister said in that I think that sometimes there's a period where you have several factors that come to the head at the same time. And one was, as you mentioned, social media, obviously now allowing a wider conversation more quickly about something that has been going on for years. The conversation about the Academy Awards and race has never stopped.
Right.
It's been going on since the beginning, really, of motion picture film with the NAACP protests, The Birth of a Nation.
I mean, the Hollywood NAACP branch is essentially, its job has been to hold Hollywood accountable.
Exactly. Right. And so that conversation was magnified in the social media universe. But at the same time, I think you also were having the emergence of a sort of, and I don't want to use the word new, but certainly a more visible emerging Black filmmaker sort of base with the Ryan Cooglers and so forth coming to the fore at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
You get a Black female president of the Academy, you know, for the first time. So all of these factors together, I think, really magnified something that's been old and ongoing and actually goes on every year, either with the television season. Every year there's some article in the LA Times or something about race in this season of television or something, or right? So in that sense, it was ongoing, but it was magnified with all of the sort of emerging films and the social media put together.
So let me ask this. High-achieving Black folks, high-achieving women, often find themselves in conversations about imposter syndrome, right? You know, do they belong here? Is their success created out of the context of someone, you know, making it easier for them to be successful? So that when you see all these nominations, right, you know, are you thinking, you know, this was suggested a moment ago, are you thinking that all these films are deserving? Or are you thinking, are all of these performances deserving? And there's at least one performance we can talk about in a moment. Or are you thinking that somehow the bar had been lowered? Right? Because, you know, especially like with the best film thing, you know, the Academy has a decision every year. Are we going to nominate 5 films or are we going to nominate 10 films, right? If they nominate 5 films, do all of those Black films get left out? How about this? If they nominate 5 films, does La La Land get knocked out?
Right. It's not going to happen. So you know what's so funny about what you're saying is that, so this year could have been several years ago. Around 2012, the same year that 12 Years a Slave came out in the fall. I'll tell you why. So there were a number of worthy films, if you were, that were Black-oriented. Fruitvale, Ryan Coogler's first film, which was way ignored than it more than it should have been,
Mandela,
right?
Mandela was in there.
Mandela, The Butler, Mother George, but by my African filmmaker brother, and there was another one that starred Isaiah Washington. And in fact, GQ magazine did an article that basically went into how there are actually stunning performances by like 5 or 6 Black actors that could arguably be the best actor nods, but they like, ha-ha, like that's going to happen because they'd have to leave out Leonardo or somebody like that. And so we know they would never allow that to be dominated. So this could have happened, right, just a few years ago, but that was pre-Oscar So White, you know, and so forth, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know that I can really add to that. I think that there is probably a tendency by some in the industry to think, and in fact, I've read the words by, I think it was a white producer or a former white male president of the Academy who said, you know, we don't want to just, you know, nominate black folks and people of color just, you know, cuz. You know, it has to make sense, essentially. You know, and I think that, unfortunately, that is probably an attitude, a mindset that is pretty prevalent. But the reality is, as Stephanie just said, you know, black folks have been performing on a high level. They have been, we have been producing and directing films that are worthy of recognition on an Oscar level. And because of, you know, whether it's a combination of the number of nominations that are allowed and the number of films that are actually deemed eligible for those nominations, and the fact that the Academy has traditionally been white and male and older, you are going to get a dearth of nominations for films that speak to the experiences of people that are not white and male. It's just not going to happen. So I think there are people who believe that you are going to lower your standards by allowing in these films by people of color and featuring people of color. But I think especially, not especially this year, but certainly when you think about Hidden Figures or Fences or Moonlight, these films are excellent and they appeal not just to black people and not just to people of color. I mean, they have enjoyed large audiences. They've done well at the box office. So I'm not sure what else you have to do to meet a bar that says you're worthy.
Mm-hmm. Were you surprised by any nominations? I remember talking with Stephanie probably 3 weeks before the nominations, and we're specifically thinking about Viola's performance, mm-hmm. right? And Viola, of course, gets nominated for Best Supporting Actress.
Right.
She's the only actress in the film, right? So there's an argument to be made about whether or not she gets nominated as leading actress instead.
Right.
But I remember Stephanie thinking very clear that Viola is going to get a nod. You thought Ruth Negga might get a nod. Mm-hmm. But you weren't expecting anybody else to be in the mix, necessarily.
No. Here's the thing about that. It had already started that they were, and in some of this is the PR company and the movie company who want their actors to get, you know, some recognition. So they put them in categories that they think, too, they start to promote them in categories that they think it is more likely for them to get the attention. So some of that is placed there. But the other part of that is also the politics, to me, of the Golden Globes and the Oscars, which says, you know, what happens if you have a category where you're going to nominate five actresses, right? But it'd be unheard of you of it not to nominate, say, Meryl Streep. I honestly believe that this year was a perfect case of like The Martian last year, because we got to give The Martian something. So create comedy, something, and right. Slap it in the comedy that even Matt Damon knew it didn't make any kind of sense, right? So this year, in Meryl Streep, who is a phenomenal actress, but that movie is not phenomenal that she's nominated for. I said it. There's that.
Can we talk about that film for a moment? Because that speaks to the politics of Hollywood. The fact that someone greenlit that film.
Right.
This is a film about a woman who can't sing who decides she's going to sing. Who thought that that would be an interesting movie that they? And so, if you can greenlight that,
it could have been, but it's
you
not.
You can greenlight anybody's movie.
Right. It's pretty good. Don't you think that there is? I think the fact that we have films like, I can't remember the name of that film.
Foster Jenkins. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. And then
Florence Foster Jenkins.
Yeah. And then this year's La La Land. you know, which is, I haven't seen, I intend to see, because I want to see what, you know, all the hoopla is about.
I've seen it.
But tell us about it.
Well, I'll say this. So I was prepared, I was skeptical. Can I'm going on record. I was a La La Land skeptic. Went reluctantly the afternoon, because I'm like, oh, and I'm going to be honest, I love all kinds of genres of films, but I'm not in love with the classical sort of Hollywood musical film. I love Stormy Weather, but because too white, too like Frank Sinatra, I'm sorry, I just never loved them. So I wasn't really expecting. So halfway through the movie, I'm like, okay, this dude is a genius. Here's the thing about La La Land. It only a film student, and I don't mean someone that just has a formal education, but someone who seriously studied film, all genres, understands different, you know, from the camera angles to the genre of the musical, could have produced that film. It's very intricate, and it's very layered, and it's the type of film you park a student in from and say, like, you know, study that, like I would do Moonlight, in a different way. So when I tell you that, though, Moonlight is certainly a sentimental favorite and a very worthy film, so I won't be mad if it, like, you know, messed up and won Best Picture for the Academy Award, La La Land really is totally deserving of a best film or a best best director film. I have to go on record of saying that, because it is very intricate, the layers of that film. It has so much in it. It's a filmmaker's film, is what I mean. You know how some films, it's thematic, it's the story. Well, he's taken a story that is not all that exceptional. It's about two ambitious people fall in love. They're trying to pursue their different Hollywood dreams, but he makes it very new by mixing these genres and modernizing it on so many levels. And it's very intricate to direct something like that. So I have to give it to him. I mean, he is the director of Whiplash, so we already know he's no joke when it comes to directing, but it would deserve that. So it, I think there's a little play of hating in the fact that you immediately go, here is a typical white Oscar Hollywood film. And then I sat there and I'm like, but this is a good damn film. It's a film that a filmmaker, a true filmmaker, makes. So,
but see, I think that actually speaks to the point that I was going to make, because I think that there, well, clearly there are more opportunities for white filmmakers to make a film
and get it supported,
and get it supported.
Yes,
right. Because yeah, I'm going to go on record as saying as well. It seems to me to be completely frivolous, and so, you know. I would like for us to get to the point, and I think this is part of what April Rain was saying with Oscars So White. It's not so much that we just want to be nominated. Can we get a green light for a film?
Can the films get made?
Right. Yes. Right. Can the films get made? Can there be some sort of acknowledgement that, you know, there are stories yet to be told that are worthy of being told, and there are filmmakers out there who can tell these stories and make them just as intricate and layered, who are students of film, who love film and want to make really complicated and you know, exquisite films, but are not given the chance.
Well, that can't happen even when black directors are likely to have to fight even to tell stories that are supposed alternative stories. I mean, and I'm sure we're going to get to it, but I mean, Hidden Figures is directed by a white male, and I have wondered since the beginning, had that been directed by a black female filmmaker,
would it be
what kind of attention, with that cast?
Not named Ava.
Not named Ava. Right. And not named Ava at this point. What kind of attention would it get? Because I know plenty of very well-established filmmakers who have pitched stories like that. When you're friends with them, they will share the actual real war stories of them and them going, why would we make a movie about black women doing something unusual like that?
Right.
They've been told no for years.
Right. Think about it in the context of Hidden Figures, right? You have Margot Shetterly who writes the book, and there's already an investment on the publishing side of this, right? Because it turns around, the book comes out in September, the film's out in January. So both of those things are already in motion, right? It's not like the book came out and everybody read it and it's like, oh, let's make a movie of it. Mm-hmm. It's occurring at the same time, right? And that takes a certain kind of influence, right? It's always going to go to a white director in that context.
And you, probably male, and a right, white male yeah. one, lest we forget. And it's not very, and I'll be totally honest with you, I love Hidden Figures, make no mistake, because of the story, the true story that deserved to be told, and because of that cast. But the direction is not inspired at all. That is 1, 2, 3 film directing. There is nothing remarkable about the film direction. Notice it is not in a best directing, you know, category, and deservedly so. It should not be. I know 100, you know, directors not white and male that could have directed that, complete down to the cute little dance scene with the ladies, because you must have that in these black women in a serious drama or comedy for it to be sellable. And not too heavy and so forth.
So let's talk about a nomination that I think is not deserving, right? And then this is going to be blasphemous.
I've already started this.
But I don't think Denzel Washington was deserving of a Best Actor nomination for Fences. I thought it's a role that he had played many times on stage. Right, I think he said 114 times, specifically 114 shows he did. It felt as if it was a caricature of Denzel. It was like you're watching Denzel play Denzel in a movie called Fences. But that speaks to the politics of the industry, because the other side of that is that part of the reason why his acting might not have been inspired, or I won't say it wasn't inspired, but wasn't so, you know, on point the way we expect it to be, because he's also doing double duties of directing, exactly. Right? And where he should have got the Oscar nod
was in direction for
Fences, because, you know, to take something that, first of all, is set, you know, on stage, right, doesn't very, and to be able to capture that, but also present the scale of that in a way that someone can see in a movie screen, and at the same time celebrate the Hill District in Pittsburgh, you know, in a movie that's, again, basically set in a backyard, you know, most of the time. I mean, that's what he deserved a directing nod for, but he wasn't going
to
get that.
No, and I've been saying that to anybody who would listen, that once again, of course, Denzel Washington is not even being considered in the best directing. Although the thing is going to be nominated for best picture and it's getting this, they're going to ignore that as if that, you know, he did not, you know, take on a major role in doing that. Some people argue because it's a play made into a film and it still has the theatrical. But I'm like, what does that have to do with? That would have been the more interesting nomination. And I think the more meaningful in his career at this point.
Absolutely.
It would have been that. But it's almost like the pocket that Hollywood has in their mind of Denzel Washington is as the actor. And because the character he portrays is this larger-than-life character, the Troy character, it's that, you know, the on-stage, the on-screen thing is what people want to keep
but yet
rewarding.
Mel Gibson
can do both, right?
He can be nominated for both.
Sure, right? He can do both. It's a very strange thing.
Even after he's been jettisoned from Hollywood, right, he can get nominated again.
And some people who should have, the people who should have gotten in that cast that should have gotten nods, being totally Michael T. Williams, who is the most brilliant thing in that cast, along with Viola, as Gabe, as the when has a mentally ill person been portrayed with such dignity and just, like, if you want to teach acting to somebody, it's like, sit and watch that. Because it is perfect. It is a perfect.
It's Rain Man-esque.
It is, and better, in my opinion. And there's no Golden Globe nomination. I don't even think he got, even the NAAC Image Awards, even our own folk ignored Michael T. Williams' performance.
We kind of follow the way of the Academy Awards and the Golden Globes. We rarely deviate that much. I'm talking about in terms of the Image Awards and the NAACP Awards.
Although at least Birth of a Nation was mentioned in his... And Nate Parker is in the NAACP Image Awards.
So let's just go there.
Where are you at? Where are we going?
You know, if you go back to May of last year, all the conversation was about Birth of a Nation, right, and how it was going to dominate, right? Nate Parker was going to get all these kudos for both his acting and his directing, right? We know what went down, right? That didn't occur. But yet we're still hearing all this buzz about Manchester by the Sea. And the only real differences between the two male figures who are at the centerpiece of these two controversies is that one settled with two women, and thus, you know,
in recent history, in 2010, recent history. I believe.
And even though the other one, and we could have a whole conversation about guilty, not guilty, what occurred, but it does seem as though there's a double standard here, right?
Same.
I'm trying to be diplomatic.
Well, I mean, I don't know that you can be. I mean, the reality is, and it's complicated, right? Because there is, I think that it was reasonable for the type of backlash that Nate Parker and his film experienced. And I think that there are things that he could have done to circumvent that, that he did not do. He made a choice not to do. But, you know, I think if we think about how black men are represented just culturally, I mean, like Ava DuVernay's 13th documentary was nominated for Best Documentary, you know, this year. And it perfectly explains and gives the historical context for why we have this image of black men as criminals, of black people in a certain light. And, you know, that I don't think that that has escaped Nate Parker, especially in light of the fact that he was accused of raping someone. So when I think, I'm not surprised, I guess is the point, that there would be this disparity between how Nate Parker has been treated, how his film has been treated, and all of the potential for that film, how it was completely sort of derailed by the controversy. And then, I can't remember, Casey Affleck and Manchester by the Sea did not experience that same type of derailment. I mean, it's no different than the Stanford swimmer, and there was another black athlete, a football player, might be at Stanford, I can't remember, but two cases going on at the same time, and the way that they were dealt with, both in the public eye and through the criminal justice system, I mean, night and day, so it's not surprising.
Yeah, and you know what disturbs me about what happened, how things have gone down, they're still going down because we're in the middle of award season and it's been made to be all, you know, basically invisible, right? Is that I think the politics of representation are as disturbing as, you know, what happened, what, 20-something years ago, but is disturbing in light of how black men are then, if I am acquitted of a crime, and if I maintain my innocence, I'm saying, right? But the court of public opinion has decided that I, right, then I'm expected, though, to behave and speak as a guilty person. And if I don't, then I'm going to be, you know, basically summarily punished. Now, what's and I think that this happens a lot with black men. There's a certain way, if they commit or if they are thought to be sort of villainous in some way, they also have to represent themselves as sort of like, you know, head between their legs, a dog, you know, tell like, please forgive me, I'm, you know, sorry, in some kind of way as well, to make that okay, right? To get acceptance, to say, okay, we're going to let you go with that. But I don't recall, I have never heard Woody Allen groveling about, and he's currently making a movie that Justin Timberlake and Kate Winslet are going to star in, and a whole bunch of other Academy Award winning folk. And we go back to the history of motion picture, go back to Charlie Chaplin, whose propensity for 16-year-old girls was well noted, and he married one. I'm Charlie Chaplin, who we acclaim as one of still the great filmmaker, and I love the films of Charlie Chaplin. So I'm saying it's very troubling to me that we can pick and choose, though, in the court of public opinion when it comes to art and what have you, who is going to be, their art is going to be deemed then null and void right. over here, while others of a certain privilege, be it racially or gender, can be let off the hook, so to speak, or we can separate somehow their art from our personal distaste for their behavior.
Yeah. Let's talk about, though, what that looks like in the Black community, right? Because when you first hear cries about boycotting, that's not coming from white folks, right? That's coming from Black folks who are talking about boycotting Birth of a Nation, right? And so for a moment, talk about the politics of boycotting. And one of my other favorite interlocutors, Lisa Thompson, teaches down at the University of Texas, we went back and forth with this about the function of the boycott, because ultimately there are folks who did labor on that film, right? Actors, producers, writers. I mean, when you talk about, you know, it's one thing to boycott R. Kelly, you're really just boycotting R. Kelly, right? To boycott a film is to boycott a team of maybe 450 people. Right. Like, some guy was a grip on that film. And his ability to do his work going forward because this film didn't get recognized might actually impact him. He might not have ever met Nate Parker, you know, let alone actually have some sort of connection to the film. Mm-hmm. You think about an actor like Coleman Domingo, right, who does a very good, extraordinary performance in the film, right? And again, Nate Parker is one thing, but when you have these other extraordinary performances that are lower on the register, where this film might have been the thing that broke them through, right? Mm-hmm. All of that changes when you decide, well, let's boycott this film. And the question becomes, how effective is that if we're going to have a real conversation about sexual violence against women, a real conversation about rape, is what's more useful, boycotting a film or actually like giving donations to be able to prepare rape kits, right? And we weren't having those conversations. No. It seemed to be more about the gotcha moment. Of catching Nate Parker.
Sure, and you know what it wasn't about? I mean, and I said this in my review of the film, which turned out, of course, to be very different than the one that I was going to write when I saw an advanced screening of it way back in May, is that I said this was an opportunity, though, to have a larger conversation and for Nate Parker to participate in it. This is where he erred, in my opinion, about this culture of excusing boys will be boys behavior in college. This notion that part of the fun, the partying of college, is that I conquer as many women as I can sexually, however, in whatever circumstances, you know, right, that I can. That is part of the culture that predates Nate Parker that is still going on. And to act like he is in some, that even in that situation, that was sort of an isolated individual. When we're talking about a whole culture still going on that sets circumstances for rape to occur and assault, because you're supposed to party and drink out of your mind, because and then they're just being children, you know, right. Young people.
It's a Stanford.
It's like romantic.
It's a Stanford swimmer's father going, don't destroy his life. Mm-hmm. Right, you know, by sending him to jail for rape. And that's part
for
of
doing what teenage boys do in right. college, right?
I think a couple of things. I'm glad that you brought up the question of, you know, why haven't we had or what kind of conversations could we have had about in the Black community around this Nate Parker controversy about how we deal with those of us in our community who have, my mind is going blank, who have committed sexual violence, have committed some sort of rape, sexual assault, you know, and still, I guess what I'm hearing you say, Mark, is support the work so that the people who have done right. the labor can benefit from that work. And you know, we can too. And I think that some of those conversations did take place. I think that part of, and I know this is not, you know, we're not going to just focus on Nate Parker, but I do want to say that I think that part of what, for lack of a better phrase, sealed his fate was that he seemed to be, when the controversy arose, he addressed it But he was saying things like Stephanie is talking about, that where he seemed to be excusing the behavior. Not that he should have been totally retried at this point, but it didn't seem that he understood the impact of how what he did and then the film that he had just created was triggering for members of at least our community, of the Black community, who have gone through sexual assault, who are survivors of sexual violence. And it seemed that he was on a road to actually address and deal with exactly what you're talking about. There was a pivotal moment when he was interviewed, I think, by Ebony, and he said, you know, that he wanted to do something to address the issue of sexual assault and rape, and he seemed to be moving in a direction that was going to be, you know, that was going to be useful, that he was going to take that, what he was learning from that moment, and apply it to, you know, what we need, really, you know, what Stephanie was talking about in terms of the type of culture that we continue to live in, and the fact that we continue to need to have these conversations, and nothing really seems to be done about the incidents, the rate of sexual violence that takes place, not only in our culture but certainly in the Black community. And then he you know, it's like he did this, you know, 90 degree or 45 degree turnaround from where he seemed to be going. And I think that's what, you know, at least people that I know and that I have observed talking about this and having conversations about this seem to really bristle at and be very offended by, was that, you know, you seem to understand in one moment how triggering your behavior, and not so much your behavior 20 years ago, but how you're talking about it today was for so many. And then that didn't seem to matter. You, in service of your film, you wanted us to go support something, and you didn't want to have any responsibility to how that film was going to affect, you know, women who are survivors and just the culture in general. The rape culture in general. So I just wanted to say that because I think that there was a lot of talk, there was a lot of conversation and a lot of debate back and forth about to what extent do we, you know, not support this art. We have Miles Davis, we have, you know, James Brown, we have all these other examples of Black cultural producers who we still listen to, who we still support. So, you know, just I think the fact that I really believe it was hashed out like ad nauseum is something that we, you know, we have to kind of embrace. And certainly the conversations are not over. And I don't appreciate the fact that Nate Parker, his film was basically canned in a way that
was killed.
Yeah,
I mean, let's go. Yeah. It was murdered and
it was
left. And in doing so, to me, it was like a double murder in a way of Nat Turner, which is something that I think it was convenient to have it die, because we would have to deal with one too many Black oriented films and who deserves the best Oscar, because we might have five in that category. Mm-hmm. And then it was Nat Turner done in a very unapologetically pro Nat Turner esque way, which has never been something that mainstream America is still grappling with Nat Turner and tends to deem him a murderer, still, right? While most Black folk don't in that way, right? But history is still, mainstream history still deems him an anti-hero rather than a hero.
Right.
Natalie, you mentioned Ava DuVernay's 13th. There were four Black directors or directors of color nominated in the documentary film category. Ava, of course, for the 13th. Roger Ross Williams for Life Animated. Raoul Peck, I'm Not Your Negro. And Ezra Edelman, who's the son of Marion Wright Edelman, for, you know, O.J. Simpson Made in America. I want to highlight those films for a moment. One, to think about the 13th, because the majority of people who saw the 13th did not see it in the movie theater. They saw it on Netflix. Right. What is Netflix doing, one, to change the game? When we go to O.J. Simpson Made in America, the majority of people who saw that over a period of 6 nights
on ESPN.
It's like, well, why is this something, right? Because it gets nominated in the Golden Globes in the miniseries category. Mm-hmm. Right, but it gets nominated in the Oscars as a theatrical release. Mm-hmm. Right, someone sat in the theater for 7 hours, presumably, and watched that in the movie. And then you take Raoul Peck's film, you know, I Am Not Your Negro, right? And then what has been this Renaissance moment for James Baldwin, you know, 30 years after his death, and now his words, you know, being brought together, being imaged, if you will. Is there something to be said about the preponderance of people of color in that category? Is there something about this desire to still attach black cinematic talent to some form of realism? You know, think about how Hollywood thinks about Spike Lee, the documentary filmmaker, versus Spike Lee, the narrative filmmaker. Mm-hmm. Right. In some ways, he has a greater reputation as a documentary filmmaker, right, than he does in terms of, and you know, you look at the last 10 years, that might not be wrong. What is it about that category now that carries so much in terms of these issues around, you know, black identity, blackness, black politics?
So here's the thing about documentary and filmmaking. None of these categories have been historically friendly to black filmmakers.
That's right.
And and it is another manifestation of the time and the moment we're in, which is still very heightened and sensitive to the Oscars so white backlash. Because if it wasn't, there's no way that Spike Lee's Four Little Girls or another would not have won. That was a best picture. That was a best documentary. Mm-hmm. And for sure, right, that really should have been his Academy Award win. So we're seeing in that documentary space, I don't think as much this ideal about the realism, because the documentary filmmaking category ain't loved black American film directors as well, mm-hmm. historically. You know what I mean? Right. Like, there's no big tradition of us talking about, ooh, look how many black, you know, filmmakers in the documentary film cat. It just really hasn't been the case. I 13 and Lion, I think Lion's in there too, right? It's Lion, I think, right? Are two of the right ones, I think, that are in the documentary filmmaking, if I recall correctly. And of course, I'm rooting for one of those. And for James Baldwin, that is more of a manifestation of the time of James Baldwin, like James Baldwin in some ways coming into the contemporary consciousness amid a Black Lives Matter sort of radicalized mm-hmm. environment, where his words and his work, and also coinciding with our now, you know, the gay rights movement in contemporary times, and going and looking at now black and other people of color, artists and intellectuals who were ignored in some ways or marginalized in a way because of sexuality and race. And I think that's part of why now, I wouldn't say he's in vogue, but there is a way in which going to the work of the civil rights folk, especially like him, who were involved with that in a very unique way, has become a larger sort of like focus in the public mainstream. Although I will say that, having seen I Am Not Your Negro, we did an advanced screening of it at Morehouse, right before it came out, February 3rd. I actually was surprised that it got nominated for an Oscar. And not because it's a bad documentary, but because I do not think that it was the type of done so well as a documentary that it warranted that, and that there are just others in there, 13 included, that are way stronger in terms of the filmmaking. And because I'm familiar with Raoul Peck pre this and can testify that he can do fine documentary work, it's proof positive in Lumumba, which was a way better done documentary, is what I'm saying. The subject of I Am Not Your Negro Baldwin is compelling.
Right.
It's all Get Out. But the actual filmmaking, the making of that documentary is in no way even close to the quality and just the overall, you know, kind of artistic level that Lumumba was.
See, I disagree. I disagree. I disagree. I think that I Am Not Your Negro is, so Mark and I were, and somebody else in here that was, and well, Israel Durham back there, he and some of his fellow grad students produced a symposium this past weekend on the 3rd and 4th of February. And the way that that symposium closed out was with Mark having a public conversation with the cinematographer and filmmaker in his own right, Arthur Jaffa, who, as you know, shot Daughters of the Dust and shot quite a few Spike Lee's films, and Greg Tate, who is a very veteran cultural critic. And AJ, as Arthur Jaffa is called, showed a new piece that he, I guess, created, what, within the past 6 months?
6 months. Yeah. Love is the message, yes. And the message is death.
And, you know, it's 7 minutes long, and that thing wore each and every one of us out. And I bring it up because if you have the chance to see it. And I see it, I see I Am Not Your Negro sort of in, I see love is the message and the message is death in the same tradition of I Am Not Your Negro. Because I think that when I saw I Am Not Your Negro, and I've seen it once and I probably need to see it 5 more times to really process everything that's going on, it's not traditional documentary filmmaking in any way. It absolutely requires you to be plugged in from the very beginning to the last moment. And there are parts, I think, especially in the beginning, where it's difficult to really engage with it because you're not sure what's going on. But I think it is a piece of art, and a piece of art in the tradition of, you know, Basquiat, where you are looking at something and trying to, get your life while you're looking at it. That is what I Am Not Your Negro is, at least for me.
Well, see, here's what I mean by saying that it's not, it doesn't approach. I appreciate I actually like the approach to it. It's Baldwin's voice, and he's moving from a work of his, and that makes it unique. Here's where I thought his choices as a director did not lend to that very unique thing he was doing with the piece. The choice to be so influenced by what's going on in the contemporary times that there is too much of, I found it just sort of excessive and not really lending to what he was doing aesthetically and to Baldwin putting in, for example, the contemporary pictures. It was almost like, you can trust James Baldwin's voice to resonate, and we don't need to cue now the picture of the Black Lives Matter. I didn't think that lent to the. That's what I meant by there are choices that he makes as a director. Cue now Tamir Rice and all of the line of pictures. That was just kind of one of those. That to me, what is a typical move that people make? But it didn't lend to the unique thing he was doing, and he didn't need it for us to get the contemporary. You know, weight right. of how Baldwin's voice still resonates as he's talking about race in America.
And you think about that, for instance, in the context of Fences, how much reverence Denzel Washington had to August Wilson's words, right? You know, so those are two different, very different ways to deal with words and language in that kind of context.
Yeah.
Let's talk about, because these questions raise a lot of things, you know, this is about Black Hollywood. When we think about Black Hollywood, inevitably, we think about actors and actresses. We might think about directors. There's a whole body of folks who contribute to this that we don't know, right? Mm-hmm. So you take someone like Bradford Young, who has been for a long time, Ava DuVernay's cinematographer, just recently shot a video for Common. But he gets nominated as cinematographer for Arrival, right? And Amy Adams' film that's not about black people, right? You take someone like Joy McMillan, right, who gets nominated for editing, right, you know, for Moonlight, right? And if you've seen Moonlight, it's deserving, right? Even if you don't know anything about editing, right? You can tell that there's something, you know, special that's occurring there. Mm-hmm. You know, Steph and I were talking beforehand about how do we think about black film, the totality of it, where we're not only just training people to be great actors and be directors, but all this other stuff. How do you be a good cinematographer? How do you learn editing, right? We need to be teaching, like if you're 17 years old and you want to get into film, how about you teach somebody how to edit first, right? And again, we were talking about, you know, AJ's film, Love is a Message. It's largely about what he does editing, right? You know, he's a cinematographer, but his genius in that is what he edited. Yeah. And then the piece around criticism, because as I'm listening to your conversation, right, this is a conversation between two highly skilled critics and theorists of film, right, who can talk about, like when you talked about La La Land, right, not everybody has the capacity to see La La Land and see that La La Land's in conversation with all of these traditions, right? What most people see is a bunch of colors and some landscapes and a white guy that you wouldn't mind having sex with. I mean, that's what most folks see. You know, when you hear black people talk about a film like Love Jones, right? And I love Love Jones, and but it's not a good film, right? It may trigger some interesting. So how do we start also talking about building up a critical voice, right? Because this is why La La Land is La La Land, because there are critics throughout who are skilled critics who can talk about why this is special. Right. Comparatively, we don't have those kinds of voices on the critical side. Right. Black folks, you know, who can elevate the conversation. I mean, we could say this same conversation about music criticism, about literary criticism. You know, if there's anything that the kind of accessible public criticism of black art by black folks lags now, right? There was a tradition of it before. Right, but lags now, you know, in comparison to what we might see in terms of other mainstream critics writing, you know, about culture.
So you've just said a lot, and I want to start with your first one before I move to that criticism one. That the first point you made, which is about how we're underrepresented in other areas. We're not just talking about on screen, but beyond screen, which is something that when Oscar So White happened, I had all this, the media folk calling, the LA Times, and you know how to call, because they need a black critic to, what you think about Oscar So White? And so one of the things that I kept saying was, but it's not just representation on screen, it's beyond the screen, it's off the screen. Oftentimes, even when you have a so-called black film, you look around and the crew is white. You might hardly nary see a black camera person. This is like real. If we were to even look at some of these movies that you might be surprised at, literally, right? That goes even bigger if you from big films like Marvel, you know, classics, Marvel films that have $100 million plus budgets, and you go on set, you can count those black folk on one hand. I'm talking about camera people, editing people, and people don't know people. Like I toot the horn a lot of people like Wynn Thomas. Do you know who he is? He's a black production designer. He did Cinderella Man. He did a Tim Burton film. He did most of Spike Lee's films. He did Hidden Figures. He's production designer of the year. Right. And he and I talk all the time. And we're always talking about how people don't know. Right, people like him who have been working all this time on all of these major films, beautiful work, nominated up to, you know, Wazoo, and how more young, you know, people of color need to understand, who love fashion, who love art, who love all these things, but are not really thinking of making their way in film as a production designer, don't know any production designers by name, don't really... They don't have mentors in the, you know, so it's a huge thing. Yeah. And so Hollywood, fundamentally, if we get confused with all the glitter of who's nominated, trust me when I say Hollywood, both in TV and in film, can keep ticking away just like it always has been, if in the executive room and in the crew room, you still see a very, very limited, diverse body of people who are traveling from film to film, making money, and it's like 98% white. Right. That's what happens in Atlanta. It's like 98% white from LA coming in, it being parts of all this, you know, production. And the last thing I want to say is that part of that whiteness extends to film criticism, mm-hmm. to contemporary film right. criticism. Right. I recently did this research where I went to the one white film critics board, and I was like counting up the women and the black folk. It's like one. Because the way they're measured is even though I write extensively about film and on your blog, you know that, and even, you know, your piece in like The Atlantic, but if you're not attached to the New York Times right. or the Chicago, those are really typically very white male spaces. There's a few women scattered in there, largely white, who are the people who are the people who combine in some cases, a film, you know, formal knowledge yeah. with film, you know, right? They're also the ones writing about film and all of this kind of stuff, too. They have also a very elite voice and a very large, dominant sort of voice.
Yeah. I mean, everything that you are saying, Stephanie, I totally agree with. And, you know, as an instructor, well, both of us are instructors at historically black colleges and universities. And the one that I teach at is extremely small and financially struggling, and a lot of, I mean, well.
Song,
I mean, yeah. I mean, you know, whether you're a Morehouse or a Howard, Hampton, maybe not Hampton as much, but, you know, a lot of HBCUs are struggling financially. And especially under this new administration, there, you know, who knows if they how they will weather this storm and whether or not you know, we'll get the resources that we need to continue. But as someone who teaches film at a small private HBCU, I can't tell you how frustrated I get with the fact that students are very sort of tunnel visioned as far as what they want to get into. They want to be a director, they want to be a cinematographer, but they don't want to really learn how to edit. They don't really want to learn how to produce.
They don't even like watching films.
They don't like watching films, right. And so how are you going to cultivate a critic if you don't want to watch a film, if you don't want to learn how to read a film? You know, so yeah, you're right. They don't really want to watch films, and I find that, and I think this is, you know, it's like a pipeline issue, because I think Hollywood, because there is a certain type of film, when it is about black people, that gets made, generally, right? You got, we tend to have the Fridays and the Boys in the Hood and the Fast and Furious, even though that's not a black film, but, you know, that's the type of film that... my students, at least, are attracted to. And so when they have the chance to write a screenplay, that's what they write. You know, they write what they feel like they know, or what they'd like to see on screen, what they think is going to get them over the, you know, the hurdle. It's almost like rap. You know, you may grow up in a middle class, family, but the first thing you want to rap about is drugs and guns, right? Because that's what you think it's going to take to get you in the door so that you can, you know, eventually do the kind of stuff that you want to do. And I'm always having a conversation but sort of through the back door with my students by showing them films that they would never see right. on their own, that they would never see otherwise, and using those films to get them to learn how to analyze and read films. I mean, I also think, I have to say, that there is, let me go back to this issue of the pipeline, because I think that there's not enough opportunity for students of color to be exposed to people like Wynn Thomas, and who's the casting director? That's
Robbie Reed.
Yeah. You know, there are a whole bunch of people that kind of came out of the Spike camp.
And our sister costume designer did most of his and did Roots recently. Right, what's the sister's name? You know, she did all of his early. Who's the costume designer? She does a lot of work. She did Roots, the miniseries, yeah. The new one too.
Yeah, I mean, there we are there. I had never heard of the editor Joy that did Moonlight. So and I kind of dwell in this arena. So I mean, I think it's a matter of exposure, but there also needs to be an intentional effort on the part of. I think Hollywood has to really kind of get over itself and stop thinking that it's so progressive and so inclusive and so diverse that it doesn't need any help in this arena. And it really needs to open itself up to the possibility of partnering with a Morehouse or a Howard, places, HBCUs that have film schools, that have film programs, and bring those executives, bring those people, those crew members to the school so that kids can see that there is more to filmmaking than being a director and being a cinematographer. That you want to learn how to edit because there will be very few of you. You want to learn how to be a production designer or a costume designer or a sound designer or any of the variety of roles that, you know, are not only needing our presence, but are lucrative. I mean, these are great ways to make
thousands of dollars a day. You think about the 1960s when there isn't a black presence necessarily on the screen, but Quincy Jones is scoring films. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, folks like Oliver Nelson are scoring films, right? So that speaks to like the invisibility of a very visual medium, but folks are there. So let me ask you twofold questions before we open this up to the audience. One, your thoughts on these three films, Hidden Figures, Fences, and Moonlight. And then if there was one single performance that you wanted to highlight, whose performance was that?
I'm gonna make her go first. It's not by myself time. See how that was. Put on the spot.
Oh yes, you did.
Sister's not gonna throw it back to me.
Yes, I am. I just have to figure out when. Okay. So, Moonlight was probably my favorite of the three films, and I think it's because number one, stories about Black gay males just do not make it to the big screen. Secondly, stories about Black males, period, are rarely just painted with such beautiful strokes as Moonlight was. The cinematography, in my humble opinion, is exquisite. I think that it humanizes both the main characters and the other young men that populate the film in a way that, I mean, they are just beautiful. I mean, they're rendered beautiful. And so I think that's in a culture where Black men are demonized and criminalized, I think it's really a feat to do a film like Moonlight and have it be so well received, have it be directed by a Black male, written by, right? It's based on a story by a
it's Terrell Alvin McCrane.
By the playwright, right. It's a beautiful film. I mean, I really couldn't get enough of it. Fences, I was just in awe of, mainly because, although I can see what you're saying about Denzel probably deserves a directing nomination more than a Best Actor nomination, but because I never saw the play, Fences, it was a revelation to me.
To a lot, most people.
Yeah. It was incredibly powerful. And you know, Viola Davis. I mean, I agree with you. Like McKelty Williamson, Viola, of course. I thought that everyone that I mean, it was an ensemble piece, and I thought everyone was just incredible in their roles. And then Hidden Figures, you know, I think it is the most reflective of Hollywood of the three. And so what I loved about Hidden Figures, as Stephanie said, is the story, because that story needed to be told. It deserved to be told. But I really had a hard time with the choices that the white male director made in telling this story, and the fact that there were, things that were like plot points that were inserted in the film that were not necessary, and that, you know, basically kind of lets white folks off the hook for segregation and racism and, you know, that was really difficult to deal with while I was watching it and then in the aftermath, you know, and just thinking about it. And I kind of went off about it on Facebook. I think that all three of the films are absolutely worthy of the nominations that they have received. But I think I'm really gunning for Moonlight for Best Picture. I think that's the one that I want to see win, because I think it would be the most powerful statement about potentially where we might be headed and where we might be.
So I'm going to start with acting first and say that I have more probably issues with it, with the nominations. Like, I cannot accept Viola Davis in the Best Supporting Actress category.
I agree.
It is going to be absurd. She would probably win it, too.
Yeah.
But it's going to be absurd. And I honestly think that there is something that is deeply now politically tokenish about that Best Supporting Actress nomination category. Mm-hmm. It's like mm-hmm. the safe space.
Mm-hmm.
We recognizing,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but they're right. not never in the best. It's like, you know, being the bridesmaids
and
at the wedding.
The bride. That's right.
Like, how many times can you be the bridesmaid before you, you know, right? We had to wait every 50 years, you know, Hattie McDaniel to, to Halle Berry. It's like, wait a minute, it's too soon for another best, you know, best actress. So there's something very disturbing to me as a pattern there, like the safe box to put black women actresses.
Right.
I'm sorry, but if Viola Davis can't get a best actress nod for what she did in Fences,
right.
I don't know when the hell she gonna get one or where she gonna get it for.
Right.
I really, really do not. So that is very, the other issue that I have, which is not so much as an issue in that you're always happy when black actresses who you know are just worthy, generally speaking, overall in their careers, are getting their due. However, should Octavia Spencer be getting a Best Supporting Actress? No. I love that whole cast.
Mm-hmm.
But if a nomination was going to come out of those three ladies, what the hell is up with Taraji P. Henson?
Right,
that's where
right,
the nomination
right,
should
right,
be.
Right.
But because right now she is not mainstream Hollywood's, like, kind of the, it, you know, that's all that is. I'm sorry.
Yeah,
out of the
right,
cast,
right.
it should have went to Taraji P. Henson.
You're
so
right.
Whatever. And then I cannot accept the total sort of invisibility of Michael T. Williams, you know, as Gabe in Fences, even though, let me say this, I love Mr. Ali like everyone, but I didn't, and I'm glad for what attentions he's getting because he's been an extraordinarily great actor for a long time, right?
Marshall.
Yes. However, I'm disturbed by his nomination because I think there were two other performers not named Ali who should have gotten the nod. Those two young black males, that child actor, I forget the young man's name, forgive me, is exceptional in freaking silence. Mm-hmm. What he does with silence.
That's true.
Both he and the young man who plays Sharon in teenage years totally ignored. Yeah. Yeah. And they are the standout male performances in the film.
Right.
And it should have been recognized. But
right.
This is one of those, like, the popularity and visibility, and now that we're sort of, like, paying back our long ignoring the actor in question. But we may not even hear from these two young men, because that's Hollywood. Don't bank on the fact that it's going to launch. We can never take
careers.
That for granted.
Right.
And it would have done worlds as a statement for them, because I believe if this had been a white movie, that boy, there's no way we wouldn't be talking about, oh, look, this is one of the youngest actors ever nominated. We would have been saying that. I firmly believe that.
Yeah.
So, and Meryl Streep, as I said again, in that best actor for that no. So that's, you know, so I will take the hit for that, because I'm a Meryl Streep fan, you know, for sure, but no for that. In terms of films, I was surprised that Hidden Figures got a Best Picture nod, and it's not because I'm not loving seeing it there, because I love that this film is being successful. I love those three ladies. I love this story is so important to me on a personal level, and I think for this country in terms of history.
Yeah.
However, it's not a well-done, great film.
Right.
And even though I'm like, well, there's been other white films and they done made in that category all over the years and they wasn't great either. So, I mean, if we get one every 50 years, that's not, you know, right? Because Straight Outta Compton, arguably, even though I had issues with it and my review shows that in terms of politically, well, hell, that could have been in it, should have been in that for sure then,
that's
if
right.
Hidden Figures is this year.
Right.
But, and so, and I will say that Moonlight is certainly a sentimental favorite, and so is Fences. Fences because, to me, it is extraordinary to have the work of August Wilson.
Right, on the big screen.
Finally.
Yep.
10 plays, phenomenal writing, right. His understanding of the black vernacular voice and the jazz and blues and his ability to translate that. And for us all who don't go see plays or who don't read plays or who don't know, to get to be introduced into the beauties of that on the big screen is phenomenal.
It is a ready-made franchise.
It's a franchise.
Right.
It's a
absolutely.
Ready-made franchise.
It's a no-brainer.
Right.
And you know, and now we get to luxuriate in what some of us have known forever. So I'm loving that it is there. But Moonlight, because of its beauty and because of the beauty of the story and the cinematography.
The score.
You know,
yes.
And the score.
Yes.
Are lovely to me, and I would not be mad at all if it snuck in and won Best Picture. I do not want Manchester by the Sea to win, but I do, as I said, if La La Land wins, that is in no way, despite people, you know, loving Moonlight for whatever, Moonlight wasn't ripped off, because La La Land really, as I say, I stand by that, is a really fine piece of just kind of layered filmmaking thing, even though Moonlight is my sentimental and my kind of favorite on different levels.
We're going to hold you to that the Monday.
Right.
After the Academy Awards, we're going to do a special clip. Stephanie
see what
said.
Stephanie's response is.
Black lights and booze burn when I record for Watts, and every black like Troy Davis who never had a fair shot. All black everything, everything black, culture over everything, y'all, we taking it back, black.